Hello everybody, this is Pitch Skull Black here, and welcome back to my first Doctor Who book review in quite some time, in which today I'm doing a special one for the 60th anniversary of Doctor Who, in which today I'm going to be reviewing the 50th anniversary target novelisation, The Day of the Doctor, as written by Stephen Moffat. So without further ado, let us begin this review. So, for the exterior and presentation of this book, we have Doctor Who, The Day of the Doctor, Stephen Moffat, the Target logo at the top right there. And for the main cover art itself, we have quite a nice kind of Chris Arkelios echoing slash styled kind of montage piece of artwork for the story. We have the War Doctor, the 10th Doctor, the 11th Doctor, a Zygon, and two Daleks, one with an interesting little claw arm, with a kind of explosive, nebulous, kind of galaxy-like background. And then for the spine, we have the Target logo, Doctor Who, The Day of the Doctor, Stephen Moffat, BBC Books. I have no idea why this is, and I'm just noticing this for the first time. I don't know why those are printed at a higher elevation than those are, but it is what it is. I've just noticed that for the first time. And then for the back here, we have when the entire universe is at stake, three different doctors will unite to save it. And then we've got an excerpt from the cover art itself with the three doctors and a bit of the Dalek and the Zygon in a circle. The synopsis, bit about it, and various other bits and pieces at the bottom down here, such as the price and the barcode. The 10th Doctor is hunting shape-shifting Zygons in Elizabethan England. The 11th is investigating a rift in space-time in the present day, and one other, the man they used to be but never speak of, is fighting the Daleks in the darkest days of the Time War. Driven by demons and despair, this battle-scarred Doctor is set to take a devastating decision that will threaten the survival of the entire universe, a decision that not even a Time Lord can take alone. On this day, the Doctor's different incarnations will come together to save the universe and to save his soul. This novel is based on a Doctor Who story which was originally broadcast on 23rd of November 2013, featuring the 10th Doctor as played by David Tennant, the 11th Doctor as played by Matt Smith, and the War Doctor as played by John Hurt. And then for the interior of this book, we have Doctor Who, The Day of the Doctor, and The Changing Face of Doctor Who. The cover illustration portrays the 10th and 11th Doctors and the Doctor as he appeared during the Time War. Doctor Who, The Day of the Doctor, based on the BBC television adventure The Day of the Doctor by Stephen Moffat, and Stephen Moffat, BBC Books. Various copyright guff there, and in memory of Sir John Hurt, who saved the day. Then we have the contents of the book. There is 13 chapters to this book overall, and it spans 231 pages overall across those 13 chapters, and some various little interludes. By the point of the first episode of the revival of Doctor Who in early 2005, there had not been a regularly broadcasted series of the show since 1989, with only a failed American relaunch being broadcasted in 1996 to grace our screens in that time. Needless to say that there had been a big gap at that point. The 7th Doctor, Sylvester McCoy, was seen regenerating into the 8th in the TV movie, but there had not been an on-screen moment for when Paul McGann regenerated into Christopher Eccleston showed to us, allowing for some mystery as to what happened in between. Throughout the run for several years, a fabled time war was alluded to numerous times that took place between the Doctor's own people and the Daleks, with it presumably taking place in this unshown gap between 8 and 9. When the 50th anniversary episode was broadcasted in 2013, some criticism was launched at it because it seemed to seek a celebration of the new series rather than a celebration of the entirety of Doctor Who, which is a very fair point to make, but at the same time, what was given to us provided to be an excellent culminative juggernaut of an episode that finally shone some more light on the battlefield legend that had only been fed to us in drips and teases. Now, with the Target novelizations, I do think that they are a great aspect and piece within the universe of the franchise, as they can act as great alternative versions of a screen broadcasted story that can develop and expand what was shown. In turn, I felt that One for the Day of the Doctor would act as a good one, with many possibilities for adding to the events shown in the episode. I thought that if done right, this book could be a fantastic piece for the new series. A little disappointing for me is that Stephen Moffat tends to stick quite close to the original episode, but there are some excellent moments to be had within. It starts off with an adaptation of the mini-episode, The Night of the Doctor, something that was created in order to have a way for the Eighth Doctor to regenerate into the War Doctor, and then the book goes into the first section of John Hurt's incarnation. The novelization here got off to a very promising start, and I thought it was pretty amazing at this point. Whereas this is one of the better moments of the book, I think the self-titled chapter that we get to see much later on is arguably better, and for me it is pretty incredible. It is during this sequence where we get to see all of the original episode used Doctors ponder about the Gallifreyan weapon, the moment, and here it shows what I wanted this book to be the most. It is during this scene that the book utilises scenes from earlier episodes of modern Doctor Who in flashback-like sequences, and recontextualises them with the fact that in that particular moment, the Doctor was thinking about what he did on that day and how it has changed him as a person. For example, the coward, any day, moment from the series 1 finale, The Parting of the Ways, is one such scene used. I honestly think this is such a beautiful moment for the book and really helps to add to the finality and culminative feel that the story has, and is overall a very good way to transcribe this aspect to the page. Unfortunately, despite what promise this book had and some genuinely great moments and sequences, it's not very good overall. It started very promising, as I said, but the more I read and the deeper into it I got, I began to realise and acknowledge that it is a very poorly thought out mess of decent to great ideas and moments, fan wank, the author stroking their own shaft, and moments that are honestly so stupid I can actively feel my brain getting smoother. For example, apparently the entirety of 1960s Doctor Who was in black and white because the Doctor was colourblind. I want to continue discussing this particular moment, but I'm so confused and perplexed by how fucking idiotic it is that I'm just gonna move on. Another thing that acted like sandpaper rubbing to my enjoyment of the book was the formatting. The book has chapters, but they are shown out of sequence numerically, and there are also several odd interludes that are written like broadcasts and or transmissions. Initially, I was on board with this format, as it seemed to add to the epic time-spanning, multiple moments in the pipeline of the Doctor's life kind of thing that the TV component did. However, it just became all the more pointless later on. The interludes are definitely the most egregious aspect of this book, however, with them being extremely fan wank nearer the end that they are. The continuity that this book has as well is also very OTT and annoying. Borderline Craig Hinton kind of continuity if you're familiar with him and his efforts with Doctor Who. Now, not all of the references that this book contains I was against. An unexpected but pleasing one for me was Clara seeing a poster of one of the Peter Cushing Dalek movies when she walks into the Black Archive in order to acquire the Vortex Manipulator. This gets further developed whenever Kate mentions to Oswald that the Doctor and Mr. Cushing were good friends and that the latter kept appearing in films after even he had died. Now, since that primarily known for horror, but yet very versatile actor is my favourite of all time, I quite like this moment and inclusion in the book, even though Clara unfortunately has to reference Star Wars. Later on, however, the established piece of canon, according to the book, is then utilised in a very weird way. At the end, whenever the detonation has been cancelled, Moffat thinks that for some reason, the meeting between the humans and the Zygons is something that needs lengthened, so they end up watching a VHS tape of one of the Dalek movies that they so happen to find in the archive. Why of all things is this one of them that gets expanded on? Who was seriously wanting more from a scene where humans and Zygons have a conversation? Plus, the idea of one of the aliens watching one of these films is kind of hilarious to me. Why the fuck would a Zygon be interested in watching a movie in which an enemy of theirs has been idolized as a hero? In the TV episode itself, we have multiple moments where the three utilized doctors are shown together on screen and are interacting with each other. Now, it's not necessarily an issue in terms of being able to discern which is which with that, as we can easily see and identify who is who, no pun intended. But trying to transcribe that to page obviously raises a few obstacles. The novelization here ends up opting to have them giving each other nicknames, which is a good idea and way of going about this. However, I'm pretty sure their pseudonyms change often in the pages, and not only does it make it more pointless, it also makes it more difficult for me, the reader, to be able to keep a track of what incarnation I'm supposed to be paying attention to. Another thing I would like to add to this point is numerics. Now, with the TV version and the overall canonical timeline of it, it makes sense for John Hurt's incarnation to just be referred to as the War Doctor, as it'd break things up a bit in terms of that Christopher Eccleston's Ninth Doctor wouldn't actually be the Ninth Doctor anymore, for example. Plus, it also adds to the aspect of our hero wanting to forget that this incarnation happened and what they did. For the book version, I don't see why, as a standalone, unconnected to any other book's version, that they can't refer to each other numerically. Obviously, there is a bit of knowledge here and there needed going into this book about certain events, but this is most definitely a standalone read. There is also multiple points within the volume where it is mentioned that the Doctor has had many years to think about what went on during the Time War. Therefore, I don't see how it would be unreasonable that, for in this version of the story, he has been able to fathom out and been able to collect together a mental track of how many incarnations he has had and what one he is on. With each of the three referring to each other numerically, there could be a good moral dynamic moment between them within which Hurt is trying to insist that he is in fact the Ninth Doctor, but Tennant and Smiths are trying to argue with him on this. Stephen Moffat overall had something brilliant at his fingertips, and in sections he did write something that was fantastic, but the longer the book went on, the more I began to realise how poorly he thought it out. The Day of the Doctor target novelisation not only amounts to a waste of time for the most part, but a waste of something that had incredible potential that often got squashed like a pancake underneath the tire of a monster truck. Whether it be Zygons watching one of the Peter Cushing movies, to a horse called Trigger that sexually identifies as a female that is also very easily triggered, appearing on page 69, yes, that actually fucking happens. The book is often beyond stupid as well, as being extremely poorly thought out and a massive, massive mess. Stephen Moffat, what the hell happened here? 4 out of 10.